In this screencast, we're going to introduce the concept of buoyancy and a buoyant force acting on a submerged object. So let's start with an object. I'm going to pick a baseball. And I'm going to take this baseball and attach a string to it. And the other end of the string is going to tie to the bottom of a container that is filled with water. So now at this point, what I want to do is represent the pressure forces acting on this baseball in different points, where the size of the arrow I'm going to draw represents the relative magnitude of this force. So if we think about hydrostatic pressure and that being a function of the depth below the surface, maybe we look on the left side of the ball and we represent the pressure acting on the ball at that point like the following. So we would expect that at the same depth on the other surface, the other side of the ball, that we would have an arrow that is the same length representing the same kind of pressure acting on that surface. But now if we look at the top of the ball, we're at a point that is at a smaller depth from the surface than that on the sides, and so we represent the pressure acting on the top of the ball with a smaller arrow. And the pressure acting on the bottom of the baseball would be a larger arrow. I'm drawing a little bit to the side so that we can see it. And so you can see the difference in the pressure forces acting on the top and the bottom of the ball, whereas that they're equal on the sides of the ball. And if I did this all around the ball, it might look something like the following, which we really call a pressure envelope surrounding this body. Now the only thing we really care about in describing the buoyant force is the difference in pressure that's acting on the bottom and the top of our baseball. So this difference in pressure acting on these surfaces at the top and the bottom of the object results in a net pressure force upwards. This is the buoyant force. There is always a buoyant force acting on an object unless the object isn't submerged in a fluid. And right now you're submerged in air, so there's a small buoyant force acting on you. Unfortunately, the pressure difference due to air is very small and can't counteract your weight, so otherwise you would float upwards. Like what happens when we cut this string. So eventually this ball is going to come to a point where it's at equilibrium, where the weight of the ball and the buoyant force acting on the ball are going to be the same. So let's figure a way to determine this buoyant force. And to do so, let's start by writing a quick force balance. But now I'm going to do something kind of strange. I'm going to pretend our ball is now gone, and instead I'm going to represent its surroundings with a cube. Now this cube minus the volume of the ball is what we're going to examine. And so that's the shaded region in here around the sphere and inside of our cube. Now you'll see why I'm doing this in just a couple seconds. So if we ignore the direction into the screen and focus on our left, right, and up and down, then we could write four forces acting on the surface of this cube due to pressure. We have a force acting on the left side, a force acting on the right, a force acting on the top, and a force acting on the bottom. So I'm going to label this F top and F bottom. Now the left and right forces actually cancel each other out. Since the pressure is a function of depth, and for the vertical sides of this cube, the depth is going to be the same on both sides. So those pressure forces will cancel each other out. However, we do know that the pressure force acting on the top is less than the bottom. We also have the weight of the shaded region, the water that's around the sphere but within our cube that acts downwards. I'm labeling that W. And then we're going to write a new force, that's FB, which is the force of the sphere, our body, that's acting on the fluid. So this is also downward. So at equilibrium, when all these forces are set equal to zero, so we have no movement of our object, we're saying that this FB force plus the force acting on the top of our cube minus the force acting upwards on the bottom of our cube plus the weight of the water inside of this cube is all equal to zero when this body is not moving. I could also rewrite it as the following. Now if we assume that the specific weight of the fluid doesn't change with depth, we're saying it's incompressible for the region that we're looking at, we could rewrite the pressure forces, the F bottom minus the F top, in terms of the hydrostatic pressure. So this means that F bottom minus F top is going to be equal to the specific weight of the fluid times the depth to the bottom of the sphere. So we're just going to call this H bottom minus the depth to the top of the sphere, so H top. That's our pressure. To get our force, we multiply this by the area at which it applies, so the horizontal area of the top and bottom surfaces. So we could plug this here, and we could rewrite the weight of the fluid in terms of the specific weight of the fluid. So if the whole cube was filled with water, it would just be the specific weight of the fluid, again, times the height of the cube. So this is h bottom minus h top, times the horizontal area. That gives us the volume of our cube. Now if we subtract out that due to the sphere, we're just going to write the specific weight of the fluid times the volume of our sphere, or the body that we're interested in. So now we plug this in here. And without doing so yet, you should see that this term and this term are exactly the same, and since we're subtracting it out, we're left with that the buoyant force, FB, is equal to the specific weight of our fluid times the volume of our body. Now the direction of this buoyant force, which is the force of the fluid on the body, is opposite to that drawn here. Therefore, the buoyant force is directed upwards and is equal in magnitude to the weight of the fluid displaced by the body. Because you can imagine, here is the volume that's displaced by the body times the specific weight. That's going to give us the weight of the fluid that's displaced. So hopefully this gives you an idea of what buoyancy is and how we apply the buoyant force acting on an object. In another screencast, we'll work through a quick example in determining this buoyant force acting on a baseball.